Ruchem Abayim to the 14th lecture in the series of lectures, shiurim, on the section of the Rambam in the Sky for the Perplexed, the Moreh Nevuchim, on the negative theology. And I think that last time we actually ended at the very end of chapter 61, Perek Samach Aleph, I believe. And we're ready to, I think we might have begun a little bit, the Perek Samach Beis, chapter 62, which is on page 159 in the Schwartz edition. Okay, the Rambam now has been speaking about what we call the Shem HaMofurish, the usually understood to be the explicit name of God, Yud Kei Vav Kei, tetragrammaton, is something we sometimes refer to, and that the Shem HaMofurish was always is always a reference to the essence of God, which in fact is unknowable and cannot be described in any positive affirmative statement. So let's begin with Perek Samach Beis. This Tavino al Birkas Kehanim uva Shem Hashem kiksavoy asher hu Shem HaMofurish. In other words, the commandment of the Birkas Kehanim requires that the Kehanim, when they bless the nation, they would bless the nation with the Shem HaMofurish. It was not known, not everyone knew how to pronounce it. In other words, what were the vowels of the letters? Do we put an accent in any of the letters? There's a letter that's accented with a dagesh, with a little dot, not accented. Says the Rambam that this was a tradition that Chachamim would pass, would transmit to their students, Tainu, as Oifen HaGoya, the way in which it was pronounced. They wouldn't teach it to any person but their students. And the Rambam here quotes a Gemara. It's not an exact quote from the Gemara, but it's close enough, right? And LaTalmid Hogum Pam Achas B'Shavua. They would pass it on to a student once a week, actually probably means once every 7 years. Says the Rambam, Ani ma'amin shemash amu shem ben arba oisim chacham moisus l'bnei matamadim pamachas b'shuvah, ain't it rak keitz levatos. Says the Rambam, I believe that when it says that they passed on the tetragrammaton, we're not only speaking about the pronunciation of the four letters. Elagam limud ha'inyan asher lamano yichud shem zu. But rather, they taught the philosophy of the... In other words, the philosophy, the concept of the essence of God to which this name is referring to. In other words, basically, they would teach people these chapters of the negative theology. In this case, in other words, what's the Rambam saying? The Rambam says, and therefore it would be a secret. In other words, what's bothering the Rambam is, I mean, what's spurring the Rambam to say what he's saying, is that if you say it was just a question of pronunciation, why should it be such a secret? I mean, what's a secret to pronounce a word one way or another way? But if you say that somehow what Chazal said, the pronunciation, also refers to the limud, refers to the idea of God's essence, the negative theological concept of God, of necessary existence, right? Then in fact, we can understand that's what's called a soid eloki, even though I think we raised the question, why should this be such a secret? I mean, after all, doesn't the Rambam insist that this is the way we should think about a Kodesh Baruch? But we'll get to this in Bitta Shem a little bit later on. Kachaya Etzlam Shem Ben Shtei Mesri Oisius. Rambam says they had also a concept of what's called a name of God composed of 12 letters. Ashur Pachas Bekdusha Ben Hashem Ben Abi Oisius. It was less Kedusha than the name of 4 Oisius. And of course, according to Rambam, it's going to be very, very good. Because only the Shem Yud Kei Vav Kei can be God's essence. Any other name is going to actually be a combination of names, which is going to indicate some type of, I wouldn't say positive attributes, but something less than the negative theological concept of God's essence, and therefore it's going to be, therefore, ipso facto, less in holiness, less in Kedusha.
From the Gemara, it's mashma, it's mos.
B'skalav yaisal dati shlo yashzeh shem echad. Says the Rambam, I believe it wasn't only one name. El shnei shem, it's a shleisha. But rather it was 2 names or 3 names. That if you take all the letters of all the names, add them up, you get to 12. Shem zehu ayom bachanim boi kol emes shaba bekriya shem ben abi oisis. In other words, this name would refer to the four names. In other words, when we say Adnos, we really mean Yud Kei Vav Kei. In other words, somehow, just like Adnos refers to Yud Kei Vav Kei, but doesn't carry with it the inherent philosophical implications within the letters of pronunciation, so too, the, in other words, the 12-lettered name of a Kodesh Baruch Hu also somehow refers to something unique about a Kodesh Baruch Hu, more than Adnos, but it's not the Yud Kei Vav Kei itself. But nonetheless, in other words, this, at least in the beginning, this name of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, which was 12 letters, was not something that was guarded or kept a secret. So whoever wanted to learn it, limdu, no, they taught everybody, right? Lo kenshin ben Abi Yosef. Ben Abi Yosef was always kept a secret. In other words, the Shem Abba Oisias was always kept a secret. That was always a secret that was only transmitted to those people who were privy to this oral transmission. But 12, the name of 12 letters, initially, was taught to everybody. Until, of course, we'll see this is going to be a degeneration in history. When people began to, more people began to learn this name of 12 letters, what they did was they abused it. Something which happens when a person who's not worthy of understanding of, you know, dealing with a certain concept, learns something, so eventually it's a degeneration. So therefore, when it came to the time of the Beis HaMikdash, they only taught it to the Tznuim Shebekuna. Because the Shem Fush already was not being, the Shem of the Fush was already not being expressed in the Beis HaMikdash. And then there are in quotes, Shimon HaTzadik bitlu ochel v'kohanim levorach b'shem. That, in fact, actually, when Shimon HaTzadik died, then the Kohanim already would not say the priestly benedictions with the Shem of Fulash. But they would use the 12-lettered name. But then, after that, there was another history. Right? Is that first they used to teach it to everybody. When people who were not worthy, right, were taught this day, they would give it only to the kahuna. And they would say it in a way that, in other words, the other kohenim would inherit. Amar Rab Tavon says, "Pam achaz alisi acha avi ima leduchen." He went with the zayda to duchen. V'tizi osni, and he said he kept an ear out for something. Etzel koyev shematim shevliu but the imus achim akahanim. He heard that the kohenim was saying this, and so like swallowing it or saying it very, very softly.
They were saying the four-letter name.
This is what?
They were saying the four-letter name quietly while they were...
No. I think there's a 12-letter name already.
So what were they...
The four-letter name already basically was before the Shimon HaTzadik.
Right.
And then when the Shimon HaTzadik, they would say the 12-letter name.
So
then after that, there was a further generation. Right. And when Rav Tavon's time, or when Rav Tavon's grandfather was around, then in fact, actually, only the Stum would say the 12-letter name.
So what were the other Kohanim saying?
They probably didn't know it.
So what were they saying?
I don't know. So could possibly they're saying maybe the 42-letter name. Maybe the 42-letter name.
Okay?
Ha'legam kem shem ben shtemis shtayim v'aba oisiyas. It was also 42 oisiyas. Yadu l'chol v'zchul l'tfisa b'segez shal yitachim b'shem panim sh'abam yishtayim oisiyas t'yer milachat. It's impossible that one name can be 42 letters as a Rambam. Basically, there must have been a combination of names that came to 42. There's no question about it that, in other words, these letters come to refer to some type of philosophical concept. It must be that these concepts, the concepts which are being expressed by these words, somehow are coming to teach us, or referring to God's essence. In other words, why is it called a shame? If it's a lot of words, why is it called the Shem? Because all the words included in this 42 lettered combination of names is referring to one concept. And therefore we need four letters in order to explain the inyan. Because sometimes to explain one thing you have to use many expressions. Remember this. Okay. The Rambam goes on and on and on and says, therefore the Rambam says, what do we see from this? We see from this clearly that we're not dealing with pronunciation only, but we're dealing with the concepts that were communicated through these names. And obviously these concepts were transcended beyond what we can conceptually understand. That's what the Rambam is saying.
What was he trying to do in this parak?
Okay, now, that's a good question. What is the Rambam trying to do in this parak? We can stop over here. It's a good question. What is the Rambam gaining by telling me that we first had Yud-Kei-Vav-Kei, which refers to God's essence, and then we have a 12-letter name, but the 12-letter name, of course, is not the same thing as Yud-Kei-Vav-Kei. It's several words, then a 42-letter name. Okay. I think I mentioned last time that the Rambam says in Perek Ayin Beis that in fact, actually, there are certain secrets of the Torah of which we don't have a Mesorah, it was lost. Now, why in fact don't we have a Mesorah that was lost? So in other words, I mean, it's not that everybody forgot something, you know, at once. But rather, there must have been a continual decline of the generations, right? In which, in fact, actually, secrets, you know, these secrets were lost in a continual historical process, right? To the point where, in fact, actually, I think I'm sure at the very end, even the 42-letter name is not going to be transmitted. In other words, I think what the Rambam wants to do is explain to us is, in fact, why is it that, in fact, why is it that the Rambam, in order to explain the negative theology, is forced to rely upon Aristotelian philosophical concepts? I mean, don't you have a Mesorah? So the Rambam has to explain the fact that the Mesorah was broken. Well, what do you mean the Mesorah was broken? Maybe you made it up. So if the Rambam could go to Chazal and explain Chazal, we clearly see how the Mesorah was Hoylech Mamayit, and the Mesorah, the concept of the God's negative theological conception, underwent a historical, distortion and a historical degeneration. Then basically the Rambam would say, look, okay, here, see, Chazal is saying we've lost the Mesorah, we've lost the tradition, and therefore I have to be Machzeh Torah L'Yoshna. I'm required, in fact, actually, to come along and, you know, place the theological concept of God within the proper parameters, which I feel is in accordance with, in other words, the Mesorah as it existed.
His interpretation of those.
Right?
His interpretation of those Chazals.
Oh, of course. I mean, that's all the Moreh Nevuchim is, interpretation of Chazals.
It's back to being his Chiddush.
Right. It is Chiddush. But in fact, the Rambam, and look, let me tell you something. The fact is that the Rambam has done this already beginning in chapter 61. He brings Psukim, actually Nivra Olam, Hayakosh Baruch Shmoy, Shpobol. In other words, he's bringing many Chazals to explain that God and His name is one. How is God and His name is one? Because if God's name are not one, then the name is merely a description of God. But God's name is His essence itself. In other words, and before the world existed. In other words, the Rambam, basically what it's doing is that once he has presented the philosophical foundations of negative theology, he's coming along and showing us now, in fact, how these statements of Chazal, confirm in some way, in other words, the things that I'm saying. And that's what the Rambam is saying. So I think over here, he's trying to explain how, in fact, a Mesorah can degenerate. Basically, right, that's number one. Number two, there's another thing too, it's an important thing too. The Rambam, in the Moreh Nevuchim, I mean, we've spoken about this, at least shiurim, the shiurim of creation, the Moreh Nevuchim is at least supposed to be a secret book. It's supposed to be communicating Maisa Makova, Maisa Bereisha. Secrets that the Rambam feels, we will learn in B'yat Hashem, I know in these lectures, what exactly are the great secrets, what does he Where does he teach these great secrets? But it was, the Moreh Nevuchim is clearly a book that's aimed at communicating secrets, which, you know, one would say these secrets are actually can only be communicated to those people who are fit, you know, or fit. The Rambam is saying is that you see that the Shem Hashem too, the concept of Negative Theology, is also a secret. It's a secret that has been expressed in history as something which is only communicated to very, very special people. As a result of this, in other words, the concept, the negative theological concept of God, is also to be considered among those things which should not be communicated to, in other words, to the Hamayin, on to the general people, but only those people who are in a position that they could, you know, intellectually absorb it and understand it. I think that's what the Rambam is probably saying here too. But in any case, I think what the Rambam is doing is he's trying to say, don't think that what I'm explaining to you is something new in Jewish history that has no source. In fact, what I'm doing is I'm actually restoring philosophically a concept which was known previously in history. Except that what? Why do I have to resort to Aristotelian proofs in, you know, in the second section? Simply because this concept has gone through a certain amount of historical deterioration and decadence and degeneration. And therefore, because of this, people are, you know, have lost this Pesedah, in other words, this tradition, and therefore I'm coming along and using philosophical means to restore what generations knew through either Nevuah, through prophecy, or through tradition. That's, I think, what the Rambam is coming to say. Now,
it's a very dangerous idea. We're talking about the basic principles of Judaism and God, and saying there's no, we don't know what we are.
Well, actually, by the end of today's Shia, it's going to get even more dangerous than that. You have no idea what the Rambam is doing in the Moreh Nevuchim. But we will get to the Mitzvah Hashem. Okay, now, what I think is, the Rambam also speaks about, it was a generation of the 42-letter word too. That's what the Rambam says. It was a Yudas Adonis. Now, what I want to do is I'm going to skip over it now, because I think that there are a few paragraphs here, but if I spend my time reading and translating, we'll basically have a reading and translating shiur, and I'm sure that's not what you want. Those of you who would like it, I refer you to the Pinnis edition. I would like to, or, you know, refer you to the Oscar edition, but there probably will never be an Oscar edition. Anyway, but in Perek Samach Gimel, chapter 63, comes the Rambam with a very interesting thing. He says, oh, let's actually begin with the last three lines in chapter 62, on page 161, before Perek Samach Gimel. Says the Rambam, right? In other words, every name of God is nigza, means it's a description of an act of God, except for the Shem HaMefulah. This was the name of God. I want to speak about Ekya Sher Ekya. Right? First of all, it's very, very good, because actually we're in Pasha Shemois. And this is a very good, if those of you would like a vote for the Pasha.
Where Ekya is Shem HaMefurash?
We'll see him Yitzhak Shem. Ekya L'choyer is not, but L'maisel means when we pass on Shulchan Orech, Ekya is Kodesh. It's about who's what Rasher is. We'll get to it in a little while. Okay, now. Beperek Nifra, Mikem and Shish by Inyan Adin Sha'anu Oiskin by, since basically this, in other words, it speaks about what we're speaking about, the Ainu Shlila Sator and negation of all positive attributes. Okay, Perek Samach Gimel, chapter 63. Naktim HaDamu. Says the Rambam, we're going to give an introduction. And in my opinion, this is a very, very central chapter in the Moreh Nevuchim. In fact, when the Rambam says that since we got to this, we'll say that we'll speak about this. No, but since we're speaking about this, we'll speak about this. That's the Rambam's way of saying, those of you who are really attentive, my really true readers who understand things, this chapter is the main chapter. Now, Perek Samach Gimel. Naktim Hagdama. Let us begin with an introduction. V'noimar b'asher l'mash ama Moshe. Ola b'shalom. Moshe Rabbeinu at Har Chorev, right? In front of the snare, in front of the burning bush, says to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, v'omuli, they will say to me, when HaKadosh Baruch Hu says to Moshe Rabbeinu that he wants him to go back to Mitzrayim, right? And to bring them out of Mitzrayim, so Moshe Rabbeinu says, "Va'omuli ma shemoi ma oimu." If they ask me what is his name, what should I say to them? So says the Rambam, Kate Nasta Shayla Bigdas and Khut, whatever question is this? What's his name? Kakshu Shoel Mayanele Ashelin Vorov, right? The Hamo Yamino leave Lishbu Bukali ki Yaimu Loinir Echalach Hashem. Ah, so comes the guy with the Duke of the Pasuk. What do you mean Loin Echalach Hashem? Hare Boa Ma'oi, Shekach Tzorek Loima, I'll call me Shetoin Lenavua. I mean, you say every person's a Navi, you should ask the question. Achu Mevirai, you know, what's special about Moshe's question? I mean, they're not going to listen to me. Every Navi should say like that. It was, what the Rambam is saying is, why does Moshe Rabbeinu say this? No other Navi says this. Why is Moshe Rabbeinu the other Navi who says they're not going to believe me? They're going to ask me, you know, what's the name of God who sent me? I mean,
isn't Moshe the first Navi who has a
Navi? No, Rami is going to be, and Navi meant to that too. First of all, Rami is going to be Yaakov. No one ever asked them a question.
But they never had a Navi for other people.
I understand the world of Navi after that. You mean, yo, you sure? They weren't worried about that either. V'oi says, that's number one. Number two says the Rami, V'oi, im adavu kefishinira. If we learn simple pshat, meaning, what's the name of a Kodesh Baruch? What's his name? Shizu Shem Gredish Vatim, so it's a name that, in other words, everybody pronounces the name, right? Azai Achas Mishtayim. So Rambam says that one or two possibilities. I'm over on page 152. Oh, she Yisrael Kvar Yodos Hashem Azai. Either they already knew the name. Oh, she Klal Lo Shamu Oysamelo. They never heard the name. So like this, says the Rambam, either way. Ima Yodu Wetzlam, if they knew the name already, Hare Ein Lo Lamoshe Rai Bekakshum Madiyo Yisai. Shekach Yidiyosa Oyskidosa. What's Moshe telling them? They also know the Moshe Rabbeinu. Never heard the name. I know this God. How do you know the name of God? In other words, what's Moshe telling them? Either he's telling them they already know, so he's not telling them anything, or he's telling them that so they don't know, in which case he's also not telling them anything. Says the Rambam, Acharei Shu Yis'al Lo'idia Lo'is Hashem Hazeh, Erper Kodesh Baruch Hu, says to him, Lech V'yasavta Zikne Yisrael, go gather the Zikne Yisrael, the elders of the Jewish people, and they should listen to your voice. Achrei says, "Adonai Moshe, Allah Vashalom Va'amar." Hashem answered him and said, "They're not going to believe me." Shrei koyim lekach dibu yisal Allah v'sham lekalecha. Kodesh Baruch Hu said, "They listen to you." Achrei says, "Kodesh Baruch Hu said to them, Mazeh b'yadcha." But there seems to be a different question here. Why is Hashem asking a question again? In other words, they're not going to believe me. You already asked the question, "What's your name?" What am I going to say to them? So says the Rambam the following thing. Now comes the Rambam with a very, very essential, right, theme in the Moreh Nevuchim. Mashalecha ladas kach shizbar lecha kol hakosh hazeh u'mashar melach. I'm going to tell you everything that's taken away all the difficulty of this psukim. Yedei ata kamo fosomois hayu teresim shal hatzabaya bo'isim zmanim. The Rambam says at that time, the Sabaya is the Sabians, the Rambams, what the Rambam calls those people who are idolaters at that time. V'shanoshim kulam, and that most people, lemait achadim, the exception of several individuals, hayu oite v'nezora. Most people at that time were pagans, including the Jewish people, just in a little while. Anim etkavin lamuna b'yeshius v'chonius b'efsholus l'haridus ha'yeshius ha'ela. We're speaking about people who lead certain spirits and believe they can take the spirits and bring them to earth. Or l'asiyus ha'tlis mois, they made certain stones in which they made pictures of stars. Kol toyn ideas on this to his manum kula, but shetan the bola in variety show in loshis of kabbalah malak kabbalah mashal avram, but shetan shiada love yeshit ulchani shal koicho malak yetsibaze. In other words, either people claim that there was a God in the world, or they claim that they saw angels. Al shadam yitul levua mekaven shakel di bay love shalach oisai, but then a person said that God spoke to him, and he speak to the Jewish people. Zaloi nisham me'ayliv le'Moshe Rabbeinu. Was that prepared before Moshe Rabbeinu? Now, in other words, Moshe Rabbeinu, this is what you're saying, is the first person to say God spoke to me and told me to say this to you. So number one, most people are idolaters. These people would claim that they saw angels and they saw, you know, quote-unquote gods. Or they would claim, like Avraham Avinu, that a Kodesh Baruch Hu appeared to them that there's a God above the terrestrial. In other words, we don't see that the Avos, even though Kodesh Baruch Hu appeared to the Avos, to the forefather, the Avos of Yaakov, we don't see Kodesh Baruch Hu told them the same things to people. Right? God told me to do this. God told me to tell you to do this. Don't do this. He sent me to you. That was never like this. In other words, basically, they just appealed to people, not to tell them what God told them, but rather, you would say, anything was that they found directly relevant. In other words, the Rambam was trying to help people. Kiruv. He was in Kiruv. In other words, there was no message from a Kodesh Baruch Hu. But Avraham Avinu was trying to help people.
But Avraham discovered God by himself.
No, but it says a Kodesh Baruch Hu appeared to Avraham Avinu too. It was being about even a Kodesh Baruch Hu appeared to Avraham Avinu. There wasn't a clear message to people. Avraham Avinu was trying to spread the faith of monotheism.
It was only after, according to Rambam, only after Avraham discovered God, then God appeared to him.
Well, whatever it is, but he's speaking about that even when he appeared to Avraham Avinu, the purpose was not to deliver a message from HaKadosh Baruch Hu. They learn with people. They interacted with them. They try to be, they try to have a connection with them, right? Like it says, they try to kill. Okay, however, but when HaKadosh Baruch Hu said to Moshe Rabbeinu, I want you to inform people. I'm sending you on a mission. You tell people something. So he said to him, he says, right? Moshe Rabbeinu said, the first thing they're going to ask me is, how do they know there's a God in the world? Now, what does that mean is, Moshe Rabbeinu has to bring proof to a God. And after that, right? Right? I'm going to have to claim that what? That he sent me. Most people at that time were unaware that there was a transcendental God. This includes Klal Yisrael. By the way, this is actually going to be the sheet of the Rambam, the third chalik of the Moreh Nevuchim, that when the Jewish people came to Mitzrayim, most of them were idolaters. So he says, in other words, they were only able to comprehend until the highest spheres. Became a chem lo chagum and amuchash b'loy gilish lemasichlis. Most people are not reached an intellectual level they can conceive of a God who transcends the physically apparent world as we observe it. Lachach ha'diyu azak kel yediya shuyavi aleim shita'amiz b'neim es matzias ele. So therefore, Kodesh Baruch Hu told them, what do you have to explain to them? Vizel ekir shirekir. In other words, ekir shirekir basically expresses the concept that God is the necessarily existent being. That's what ekir shirekir is. As the Rambam says, Zehu Hashem anigzim in haya v'u ha-metzias. Ki haya meira al-mshacha shel kan. In other words, haya means a metzias, to exist, to be. So says the Rambam, Kol asoid hu bechazora al ois debitay atzvoy. Hamoyer al matzias patur toya sharei asher matzrich haskaris toya bechubei leah. Mikaven shimila chasera hagereres bishpat zika. K'mashbaros, and he brings two words in Arabic. Hashem arishin hu amatua hu shas ekya. I will be. Hashem asheni ekya asher hu mamish. So kiilu hu amet simply says b'fulish shamatua hu atara atzmo. In other words, basically, God and his description are one and the same. Ekya asher ekya. My description and I are one and the same. That means that God exists not as a existence, is not a attribute separate from God's essence, but it's identical with God's essence. That means God exists, but not because existence is an attribute that may or may not apply to God, but God's existence is at one with his essence. He necessarily exists. This is everything we've been speaking about in these chapters. Who heavy eifel sika mashbal zois hanimza shehu nimza umechuyav hametzias. It was basically ekya is actually the Torah's description of the negative theological concept of God's essence as a necessary that who necessarily exists. So says the Rambam on page 164, this is the thing which one can prove rigorously, as I do, says the Rambam, and Yitzhak Hashem will see in the beginning of Chelet Beis, that God necessarily exists. Hoicha boisi l'chad oid afir, says the Rambam, I'm going to prove it to you later on. Kashu yis aloi dielo l'moishis harayis ha-shabemtsis yimatsi b'tzil b'ni ha-odom. So after that he says, lech v'yazaf zikli Yisrael, after that gather, after he's proven to Moshe Rabbeinu that he is the necessarily existent being, so he says, after that, go gather the elders of the Jewish people, and he promises him at the end, Seifim she'avino mashi basati lecha, they'll understand what I said to you, and they'll makabel it. And then it says, v'sham lekolecha, as chazal lav ha'shalom v'omar, he says, Moshe Rabbeinu, and Yekabel and Tzoyis HaKochas, they'll accept all the proof. But Moshe Rabbeinu is going to go and tell the Moreh Nevuchim to the Jewish people. He's going to prove God's existence. Moshe Rabbeinu says they'll accept the Moises HaSichlis HaElu. But what about if they ask you, right? They just sent me. So then, HaKadosh Baruch Hu will give Moshe Rabbeinu the Nes, the Nes that he tells him. Now, in other words, says the Rambam, we see from this that when it says Mashmoi, right, it's not the person who sent you. Mashmoi means what is the essence of God that we should praise Him? It was Moshe Rabbeinu was coming to inform the Jewish people of a new concept of God that they had never been exposed to, because as the Rambam says, at that time most people had no inkling of any concept of a transcendental God. In other words, they were steeped in pagan culture, and their knowledge of the world only extended to the, you know, to the highest spheres, the, you know, the highest astronomical, celestial, you know, parts of the universe. Okay, now, very, very interesting. What's so interesting? What's interesting is two things. First of all, I want to go back. We see clearly that we spoke about the fact that the Rambam is mustering proofs as to the necessary existence of Kodesh Baruch Hu. The Rambam is claiming, is that what this was Moshe Rabbeinu did too? That was Moshe Rabbeinu, in a certain sense, is in fact actually doing what the Rambam is doing. The Rambam is informing people of the proper nature, the proper essence of a Kodesh Baruch Hu, right? Which is in fact actually what Moshe Rabbeinu did too. And in fact, even more so, the Rambam in the preceding chapters has in a very detailed way shown us how the concept of the God's, in other words, necessary existence, and which is identical with his essence, has somehow been lost in the Jewish people. And the Rambam is coming, in fact, actually, in a certain sense, to restore this fundamental faith. Now, this leads me to a much wider question, which I want to discuss with you. And I want everybody to really hold on now, because it really leads me to, I think, one of the most, probably what I would say, is the most penetrating and central question in the entire Moreh Nevuchim. Okay? You all know that the Rambam wrote things, other things besides the Moreh Nevuchim, right? One of the things that Rambam wrote, I think, when he was very young, in his 20s, he wrote a commentary to the Mishnah, the Perush HaMishnah, and he wrote a Hakdam, an introduction. Well, he wrote an introduction to the entire Perush HaMishnah, and he also wrote a Hakdam, an introduction to Perek Chelek, the first Mishnah in Perek Chelek, in which, as everyone knows, this is the Rambam's famous introduction, in which he sets forth what he calls the 13 principles of faith. Now, the seventh principle of faith of the Rambam is Nevuas Moshe Rabbeinu. In fact, actually, if I just look at the Shilat edition, it turns out that the seventh principle of faith occupies like one third of the area of all the 13 principles, meaning that he elaborates very, very much in the seventh principle, as opposed to, let's say, for example, the sixth principle, where he just speaks about the fundamental belief in something called prophecy. And there the Rambam goes into quite a detail. In fact, he gives actually four distinctions between Moshe Rabbeinu's prophecy and between the prophecy of all other Nevi'im. That's what the Rambam does. Now, the Rambam makes a very interesting statement, which I would like to read to you, because I feel that this statement has actually been overlooked by a lot of people. I've never seen any explanation to it. The Rambam says like this, Hayisi Reitze, I'm in the Shilat edition, on Daf Kuf Mem Beis, says the Rambam, Hayisi Reitze Levar Kan Zeh Inyan Hanifla. I would like to really explain this incredible Inyan, this incredible idea. That means Moshe Rabbeinu's prophecy. To open up psukim, verses of the Torah that have heretofore been locked. Ulavai inyan pel peh, to explain the concept of pel peh, mouth to mouth, because of the entire pasuk. Vuzulasa minyanai and other psukim like it. Lule sharizik elin yonim dakimai, but these in yonim, says the Rambam, are very, very subtle. Vistachu lahachiv rabba vakdomis b'sholim, I'd have to expound upon this. Right? Introductions, metaphors, it's a whole albit, it's a whole work. We should speak about the angels. And explain the hierarchy of angels and intellect from a Kodesh Baruch Hu. We should speak about man's soul and the koiches of his soul. Every soul is actually another translation for the Rambam. And speak about the speech, the language that's used by Nevi'im when they speak about the Kodesh Baruch and the Malachim. Even if I actually made this as short as possible, may I adapt. It would at least be 100 pages. Therefore, I'm going to leave it for its place. In the Sefer Perush HaDroshos, Yedati L'Chabroi, maybe a book in which I can explain the Droshos that I intend, Mirat Hashem, to write. Or the Sefer Nevuah, Shachal Zabai, or a book on the prophecy. Or the Sefer Perush HaDroshos, or a book studying these sages. Now, where did the Rambam write this? The Chayyar of the Rambam never wrote this book. Okay? For example, if I look at the Mishnah Torah, it's a Torah base, it doesn't give me much more than the Rambam says in the Yud Gimel Lichon. Even less than that, about Moshe Rabbeinu. The Moreh Nevuchim. There's no section of Moshe Rabbeinu and Moreh Nevuchim. So, what would I have to say? I would have to say that, in fact, that's what the Rambam wrote. This, he was hoping to, you know, to leave this for a book. I never got there. It's hard to say that, and I'll tell you why.
Some says that about the...
What?
Avraham Ben Rambam writes about in his Pirshon on the Galata that this is the book his father once wrote and never wrote.
Right, on the Galatas. On the Galatas. But the point is that I want to explain two things. First of all, is we know that the Rambam constantly edited and re-edited his works. In other words, the Rambam was editing this work here when it was already rather old. In other words, I mean, he never began the book. I'm going to speak about it. What?
But some says that about Sefer Droshes.
No, the Rambam says that, no. The Sefer Droshes. That's true. That may book about a Gadita.
I said, but if he's constantly editing, why didn't he take it?
First of all, not sure what the son is saying is actually referring to this over here.
He says
his father wanted to right? About a Midrashim. The Rambam didn't do it. Okay, but I have another question. Okay, you like this. I mean, Nevuas Moshe Rabbeinu is central in Judaism. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you're going to write a book on anything, I mean, prophecy, the Rambam wrote a book on prophecy. Moreh Nevuchim is a whole section on prophecy. What about Elohai Yesoitas? I mean, that's the Moreh Nevuchim. The Moreh Nevuchim is all the Yesoitas, the name of God, creation, the mitzvahs, you have it. Even Perush HaDroshes, maybe it's not a book on the Agadites, but certainly in the Moreh Nevuchim you have a tremendous amount of birim, not only of words, but also of midrashim. Where is Moshe Rabbeinu with the Moreh Nevuchim? And not only that, it's not like Moshe Rabbeinu, you know, there's a section of Moreh Nevuchim which we don't have. Because, for example, the Rambam was aware of this. He didn't forget Moshe Rabbeinu. The Rambam constantly says in several chapters, for example, in the second chelik, in the second chelik of Nevuchim, in this section of prophecy, he says, "I'm not going to speak about Moshe Rabbeinu here. I already spoke about him, where? In the Yad HaChazaka. And then he says over here, too, we're going to get in other places too. I'm not going to speak about Moshe Rabbeinu. I know I said something. Why did the Rambam say in the Moreh Nevuchim, I'm hoping to write a chibur about Moshe Rabbeinu? How come he never says in the Moreh Nevuchim, I'm hoping to write a chibur about Moshe Rabbeinu? He doesn't say that. And let me ask about Avraham and Rambam too. The Rambam was going to write a parasha and going to see the new one. But what about the same about Moshe Rabbeinu? That's a bigger task. The chibur and drashas is only part of the chibur and Moshe Rabbeinu. Where's the chibur and Moshe Rabbeinu? And in the Moreh Nevuchim he says, I'm not going to be Moshe Rabbeinu. I already spoke about it. What? In the Mishnah Torah. What is speak about the Mishnah Torah? One parasha in the Mishnah Torah? That's all you have to say about Moshe Rabbeinu? I find that very, very hard to believe. Rabbi Sai, how could the Rambam have not spoken about Moshe Rabbeinu? How can that be Moshe Rabbeinu? I want to go back here and what we've learned about the negative theology. The Rambam, for example, in Perek Nun Dalet, chapter 54, there the Rambam, right? There the Rambam, after several chapters in which he develops the concept of negative theology about what can we attribute and not attribute to Kadosh Baruch Hu, there the Rambam, in fact, who's the person in the Torah who's informed that no human being can ever make a positive statement or attribute anything positive about God? Who is it? It's Moshe Rabbeinu. In fact, where is negative theology in the Chumash? It's Moshe Rabbeinu. In the end of Parshas Kisisa, right? Moshe Rabbeinu, what knows God's essence? The entire sugya of negative theology is here by Moshe Rabbeinu. By the way, Derech Agav, not only the negative theology, but the concept of Jewish ethics too is here. You said it's in the halacha. In Perek Samach Gimel, in this chapter, who informs the Jews of negative theology? It's Moshe Rabbeinu. Why? In other words, he's going to come to Klal Yisrael. And Kadosh Baruch Hu says, Ekya Sherekya. Kadosh Baruch Hu taught Moshe Rabbeinu to transmit to the Jewish people the negative theology. It's rather clear that in the case of negative theology, who in fact is, who is the prototype? Who in fact is that person in Jewish history who acts as the, what you would call is the precedent for the Rambam? None other than Moshe Rabbeinu. In other words, what the Rambam is doing, it's very clear. What the Rambam is doing in the section, the chapters of negative theology, is none other than what Moshe Rabbeinu did historically at the time of Yetzias Mitzrayim. The Rambam clearly understands himself in Jewish history as performing very much the same role that Moshe Rabbeinu performed in history too. It's interesting that Kadosh Baruch Hu showed Moshe Rabbeinu Kol Tuvi in Perek Nun Dalet. That was the interconnection of all of the parts of reality. The Rambam says that's something you have to know before you read the Moreh Nevuchim. You have to know all the physics. You have to be schooled in physics and Aristotelian physics before you can understand me. Because understanding the connections between the world is necessary in order, number one, to understand God's transcendence, and number two, in understanding therefore the basis of ethics. In other words, my claim is that in the section of Negative Theology, the Rambam clearly saw his position in Jewish history, his role in Jewish history, to be parallel to that of Moshe Rabbeinu when he spoke to Klal Yisrael. And that's why the Rambam has entire chapters about Yudke Vavke. Why Yudke Vavke? The Rambam is preparing us to understand the psukim of Moshe Rabbeinu as psukim that are referring to Moshe Rabbeinu's dissemination and his transmission of the negative theological concept of God to Klal Yisrael at that time in an age of idolaters. And that's clearly what the Rambam is doing here. It's an incredible thing. And that's what the Rambam says. And the Hakdama, the Rambam says, Leftoyach Manule Psuki Teira. I want to open up the Manule Psuki Teira. What Psuki Teira? The Psukim of Moshe Rabbeinu. I want to open them up and show to you that Moshe Rabbeinu's Nevuah is very much connected with the notion of God's unknowable essence. Now, we haven't made the connection with the Nevuah, of course. We make it as Moshe Rabbeinu. Maybe you can say, Moshe Rabbeinu Lachod and his Nevuah Lachod. However, it is my contention that not only, you're not going to believe this, not only are the sections of negative theology of the Rambam acting as Moshe Rabbeinu, so is the entire Moreh Nevuchim. The Moreh Nevuchim, the sections of Tamei HaMitzvahs, the sections of completion, intellectual, moral completion at the end of the Moreh Nevuchim, there are very direct, even though they're veiled, but very, very direct references that this is the Torah of Torah's Moshe, the Nevuah Moshe Rabbeinu. In other words, I want to claim, this is a sweeping claim, which of course I'm going to have to prove to you, but we have another six shiurim to prove this. I want to claim that the entirety of the Moreh Nevuchim was not none other than the Rambam communicating the Nevuah Moshe as it could be understood at this time. That's what I want to claim. And when the Rambam says, I'm going to run a chibur, that chibur is none other than what? The Moreh Nevuchim. Of course, I have to prove that to you. I have to prove it to you. Is that a claim? In any case, there's no doubt about it. In the negative theology, the Rambam has brought up the case of Moshe Rabbeinu twice. Moshe Rabbeinu is the person who learns about the essence, or the unknowing of the essence of God. He's the person who communicates to the Jewish people, and that is clearly life imitating the Moreh Nevuchim. That is clearly the role that the Rambam sees for himself in these chapters of Negative Theology. Now, of course, I've said a very, very sweeping statement, which requires a lot of proof. Perhaps next week we'll go a little bit more into these things. I think it's very, very important. You know, the Rambam mentioned the Tzavaya, which is the paganist, the idolaters who lived at the time of Klal Yisrael. I mean, the Rambam understands in this Tamei HaMitzvahs that clearly the purpose of the mitzvahs was to direct the Jewish people from their idolatrous, you know, conception of the world towards a belief in the Kadosh Baruch Hu. And the Rambam says very, very clearly that this direction of the Jewish people, this is actually the major part of Teiras Moshe, the Vuas of Moshe Rabbeinu. So the Rambam, who actually reveals us the Tamei HaMitzvahs, is actually revealing to us, in a certain sense, part and parcel of the Nevuah of Moshe Rabbeinu. But, of course, I'm going to go into the Mitzvah Shem and Raya the next year, okay? Until then, I think we'll stop over here, because I think for the next time we'll have to go on further into this tangent. And it's chaval to actually just begin it and just cut off in a few minutes, but I'll leave you in a sense of tension, excitement, from an undisclosed place in Yerushalayim. I wish everybody had slacha, kol tov, until next week. Be well.